Hello, everybody. If you can find your way to your seats, we'll be getting started here very shortly. So just by a brief way of introduction, this is something that we, and by we I mean Boston DSA, have been trying to get going for quite some time. The very first time that we had tried to get Alex to come out here was for an idea for a conference we wanted to do last year, and that fell through. And then we were going to bring him out when he was going to one of the other chapters. Couldn't line it up, but third time is hopefully going to be the charm. And judging by how full this room is, I'm pretty happy with that. So the question that I was thinking about a lot on the way here is why Alex? And for me, what it came out to the most is that there's been this growth industry in explaining mass incarceration over the last decade or so. And a lot of those things either go towards very surface levels of explanation, right? Or are not very accessible. The other best example, right, that most people are most familiar with is the new Jim Crow. But if you think of other books in those titles, or right, in that range, like Locking Up Our Own, or John Pfaff's book, or a lot of these others, you're either dealing with much narrow slices of the criminal justice, mass incarceration issue, or don't really set the whole of policing and incarceration in a way that are accessible to people who are non-specialists. Whereas the first time that I read The End of Policing, this was something that I could show somebody who had never read anything about mass incarceration, criminal justice system as a whole, and very clearly, line by line, could get you up to speed and do so with a united analysis, right? But the problem is not that we misunderstand how to apply these laws, right? That we have to have the right set of solutions, but that the entire approach going on, not just from the beginning of mass incarceration, but from the very beginning of Robert Peel in London, where the slave patrols within the Deep South, right? That the core.
And tell you, I'm never frozen lost.
You
separated from your friends, then made your way back to the city.
Criminal justice system and how it relates to our struggles for equality in a just world than Alex. So I hope that you will feel the same way I do, and that if by the end of this talk, if you haven't read his book already, that you should do so. I believe he sold them for about $15. That seems like a pretty reasonable price to me. If not, public libraries are awesome and you should use them. So without any more delay, I'd like to welcome Alex to the talk.
Well, thank you for that very gracious introduction, and I am so pleased to be here. For those who don't know, I am a Texan. I am from Houston. I'm wearing my Houston colors today. I spoke in San Antonio on Thursday to the DSA chapter there. My mom was in San Antonio, and hopefully this will be the first of an ongoing conversation, because I do come down this way with some frequency. And I also want to bring greetings from the Central Brooklyn branch of the New York City chapter of the GSA, which I finally got around to joining earlier this year. So I'm going to start with a little story. So I got a call from a journalist a while back about a city council hearing that was being proposed in response to the police killing of a middle-aged African-American woman named Deborah Danner. Now, background. Ms. Danner was someone who had a history of mental health problems that was well known, a little closer. She had a history of mental health problems that was well known to the police, to the local health authorities, to people in the public housing authority. And she didn't have a stable place to live, but she experienced a crisis one day. Her neighbor, heard a commotion, called 911 and said, well, my neighbor needs help. And the help she got was an armed police response. The officers forced their way into her apartment, forced their way into her bedroom. She did not want to go with them. She had a pair of scissors, evidently, put them down after some negotiation, and then she's like, okay, now you should leave. And they're like, no, you have to come with us. And she did not want to go with them. So there are differences about what happens next, but the police claim that she picked up a baseball bat and the sergeant in charge of the response shot her to death. Despite the fact that he had a taser, despite the fact that he had special training about how to respond to these kinds of situations. So the phone call is about the holding of a hearing. Our progressive city council in New York City wanted to have a conversation about whether or not the specialized mental health training that the NYPD was implementing was the right training, was being implemented quick enough, was it doing the job that needed to be done. And the reporter wanted to ask my opinion about these training regimes. And I start to think about the Memphis model and CIT training and these different training approaches that are out there. And I stopped myself and I stopped the reporter and I said, I'm not actually really interested in fine-tuning the police response to these calls. I'm interested in ending it. Because the fact is that this training does not work. The only evidence, the only examples of any successful outcomes with the implementation of this training is when it is done in conjunction with an expansion of community-based mental health services. To which I say, why do we need the police? Just increase the community-based mental health services. That is the value added here. This is what's going to make a difference. Tinkering with the training is not going to help. In part because the training that is given around these mental health calls is directly contradictory to all the other training that they receive. Mm-hmm. Leaving them in this untenable position of trying to figure out which training is the right training. The threat neutralization training, the de-escalation training, the hand-holding training, the command and control training. They can't do all those things at once. And this is not a small part of policing. Between a quarter and a half of all people killed by police in the United States are having a mental health crisis at the time they're killed. And the NYPD alone goes on 250,000 of these calls every year. And while the vast majority of them, thankfully, do not result in death, very few end up resulting in anything positive for the long-term outlook of the mentally ill person that they're interacting with. Whether they take them to jail, a hospital, or back home, none of that leads to sustained mental health services that would help stabilize a person and reduce the need for these crisis calls altogether. So why is it that our progressive city council in New York continues to see the problem as one of training, which they were already doing? Well, I think part of it is because they're caught up in a kind of legal formalism, a belief that if the police would just enforce the law properly, that we would have greater respect for law, that we would create a rule of law framework that would be beneficial to everyone. This is part of what we often refer to as procedural justice. This is the idea that the problems with policing are about the implementation of policing. And that if we could just get the police to be more professional, less biased, more focused on enforcing the law, that they could win over the trust of the community and they could get back to their core mission. But this is a gross misunderstanding of the actual nature of the legal frameworks under which policing operate. There's a great 19th century saying, the law in its majesty forbids both the rich and the poor from sleeping under bridges, begging in the streets, and stealing bread. But of course, the rich don't need to do this. And the fact is that a perfectly professional, lawful, unbiased, low-level drug arrest is still going to ruin some young person's life for no damn good reason. We've had a war on drugs for almost 50 years. Drugs are cheaper, more potent, and easier to get than they've ever been. Overdoses are through the roof. Any young person in our society can get any kind of drugs they want whenever they want them. They have absolutely nothing positive to show for this war on drugs except the incarceration of millions of young people. And yet they persist in this idea that if we could just fix policing professionally, that they could get back to waging the war on drugs without so much complaining. To which I say, narcotics officers do not need anti-bias training. We need to get rid of the war on drugs. It is a horrible injustice. And this is the problem with the procedural justice movement, is that it has lost all track of what substantive justice is. Who cares whether the procedure is proper when the mission is corrupt? Because there has never been anything about the war on drugs that had anything to do with public health or public safety. It has always been a rancid politics around race and inequality and political manipulation, designed to appeal to voters with a lot of coded racist language that has resulted in the destruction of communities and no positive public health outcomes. But our leaders continue to insist that the solution to policing is a bunch of technocratic procedural fixes. One of my favorites is implicit bias training. So implicit bias is this idea that, well, we all have unconscious biases that shape our behavior in some way. And that's probably true in some sense. You know, they've done elaborate scientific research with showing people images and pushing buttons and word associations, and they get these little microsecond differences. And while there's some criticism of the underlying science, you know, maybe there's something to that. But the problem is that it imagines that the problems of race and policing are about individual level discretionary decision-making by officers. And I think part of the reason for this is because so much of the focus and attention is on a fairly small number of outrageous high-profile incidents and the desire to kind of unpack that particular incident. And so we look at the individual officer who is involved and try to imagine what could have changed that scenario. Well, maybe if the officer had been subjected to some anti-bias training, they wouldn't have been so quick to pull the trigger. Well, there are a whole host of problems with this. For one, we got a lot of explicit racism in policing. They just fired a whole bunch of police in Detroit. The racist emails, when we look at the chat boards, when we get the official statements of union leaders, there's a whole lot of explicit racism in that. But it's still, I think, a mistake to think that the race problem in policing is about individual officer decision making. It's baked into the mission of police, the culture, not just the background of the officers, but the mission of policing. tell the police to wage a racist war on drugs, it does not matter what the race or racial bias of the officers is. That war on drugs is going to reproduce racial inequality in profound ways. When we tell the police that they are the tool for solving every damn problem under the sun in poor communities, that's going to result in an exacerbation of racial inequality. And it's not just about the killings. It's about 10 million totally useless low-level arrests every year in the United States, almost exclusively in poor communities. 1.5 million of them on low-level drug charges. It's a broad problem of over-policing, of which the killings are just the most egregious tip of the iceberg. They're an for every 100 incidents that go well, there's a few that go badly, and then a few of those that result in someone's death. And we need only look at the case of Eric Garner as an example of this. 8 officers, 2 supervisors, undercover officers to arrest someone for allegedly selling untaxed cigarettes on a street corner. I don't even think you can get arrested for that in Texas. Certainly shouldn't be able to be arrested for it in New York. It's a tax matter. But of course, that wasn't why they were after him. They were after him because he was a black man in an area that's being gentrified, who was considered by the gentrifiers to be a source of disorder. And we have told the police that they are the tool to be used to manage our disorder problems. Whether it's homeless people down on 6th Street here in Austin, mentally ill people living on the subways in New York City, people sleeping on the beach in Venice, California. This is what police really spend their time doing, is managing the consequences of a system of inequality. And that has always been at the center of what police do. But what about community policing? Who could be against that? Don't we want the police to understand the dynamics in the community? I'll talk to you later. Don't we want the police to understand the dynamics in the community, to be able to kind of tell who the good people are, no, who the bad people are? No, not so much. So there are a lot of problems with this idea of community policing, however well-intentioned it might be, which in my opinion is not very. So first of all, the premise of community policing is, well, let's bring people from the community together with the police to try to figure out what the community's problems are and how to solve them. So the first flaw is that, well, who is the community that's acting in partnership with the police in these conversations? I don't think it's anyone in this room. It's not anyone who's undocumented. It's not anyone who's homeless, youths, people who've been involved in the criminal justice system, people who are having mental health and substance abuse problems, even renters. That's not who's in these conversations. The police hold all the cards in the construction of who the community is that they have these conversations with. And there's a lot of research that's been done in LA and Seattle and New York that shows time and time again, the community is what the police say it is. But there's a bigger problem that gets to really the core of what I'm talking about here, which is that the whole premise is that the police are the agency of government tasked with solving community problems. But what tools do they have to solve our community problems? They got guns and handcuffs and ticket books and coercion and threats and violence. Those are not the tools that our communities need to solve their very real problems, whether it's mass homelessness, untreated mental illness, youth violence, substance abuse, overdoses. We got real problems. But our progressive legislators and progressive mayors in places like Austin and New York and LA and Chicago, these are all Democrats, continue to tell us There is no money to pay for any of these kinds of positive community-based solutions, but somehow there's always money to add on a new jail, hire a few more police, sign a beneficial police contract, as you all well know here in Austin. There's always money for that. But there's always money to put a few more police in the schools. There's always the capacity to pass a new law criminalizing yet another behavior and filling up the jail with people. So in a way, my work is not as much about police accountability as it is about political accountability. Because the police did not invent the war on drugs. The police did not dismantle the mental health infrastructure. These were political decisions made often by people who claim to be our friends, our allies. And we have to quit putting all our energy into yelling at the police commissioner, the police chief, or going to the police commission hearing. And we've got to start looking at the people who are really making the decisions that matter here. Now, this doesn't mean that officers, police departments, and unions should not be held accountable. I think it's just fantastic the work that's been going on here about calling out the politics of the police unions, who are a major impediment, not just to putting in more accountability, but in funding the kinds of community-based services that would make our communities better. Now, they hide behind a rhetoric of, well, we fight for the interests of our members, and we want this extra pension thing, and we're just protecting their rights. But when push comes to shove, we know damn well that they do not believe that these community problems can be solved without their authoritarian and coercive interventions. They really believe this kind of thin blue line rhetoric that they are the only thing holding society together. And that is a straight up authoritarian worldview that stands directly in the way of everything everyone in this room is trying to achieve. And any politician who takes their money, responds to their pressures, is not our friend and has to be called out on that basis. We need to know who's taking that rancid money. We got to do more than that. We've got to articulate a vision of community safety that is rooted in community empowerment. It's not a technocratic strategy. We've had enough white papers about how to change sentencing regimes and fix parole. We need some community mobilization around real visions of making communities stronger places, not just counting the number of people in prison and gauging our success based on that metric. Not that that's not important, not that we don't want people out of those cages, because we do, but it matters how we achieve it. So let me just give you a few examples as I've been traveling around the country the last year and a half, hearing about the different kinds of local struggles that are underway. The first one is a more government-centered one. It's from Ithaca, New York, which you'll be surprised to hear has a drug problem, like every community in America. But they have a young mayor who understood that police were not the solution to the community's drug problems. So he said, let's take a different approach. Let's have a process where we put everything on the table. We bring in some experts from the Drug Policy Alliance, academic researchers, people who've been involved with drugs, who've been in the criminal justice system, and people from the community, and let's talk about what would really make our community safer, what would really save lives. They put proposals together, they had town hall meetings, they did focus groups out in the communities, and they produced what's called the Ithaca Plan. You can Google it. And guess what? There are no police in it. There's a whole host of harm reduction strategies like safe injection facilities, needle exchange, increased access to drug treatment, peer-to-peer drug education programs, targeted economic investment initiatives. These are the things that will make communities safer. Not charging drug deliverers with homicide when somebody has an overdose, which is what the rest of the country is trying. I'll give you another example. Some of you, I'm sure, have heard there's a major effort to close our jail in New York City, Rikers Island. And we've made tremendous progress. But the city's responding by saying, well, we just need to open new, smaller jails near the courts. And actually, we need several million dollars to do that. And people are pushing back. And one of the ways they're pushing back is with the Build Communities program. Just Leadership USA, which is an organization made up of formerly incarcerated folks, convened focus groups, work groups around issues like housing, healthcare, education, youth services. They brought in academics, community-based organizations that deliver these services, people who've been incarcerated, community leaders, and laid out a program for what would make their community stronger so that police would not be needed, so that criminalization would not be utilized, so that jail populations would decline, so that we don't need to build new jails. So you can look it up. Just Leadership USA, Build Communities Program. It's a great document. It's incredibly concrete with dollar amounts, numerical targets, specific programs that people think will make these communities stronger and reduce the social problems that we've turned over to the police. The last example is from Salinas, California, where I was fortunate enough to be last week. In Salinas, they built a broad coalition around a Build Healthy Communities model. And the idea here is, again, to develop a kind of people's budget about what is really needed to make the community stronger. And here's the twist, the part I really like, is that they're targeting specific city council members, the people who should be our friends but aren't, and they're doing community organizing, town halls, door-to-door kind of stuff around, well, why can't we have drug treatment on demand in our community? Why can't we have supportive housing? You voted to put more police in the schools. You voted to expand the youth authority facility that's locking kids up, but you won't give us these things that we know will make our community better. And I think that if they keep it up, if they do this work, they're going to be able to get rid of some of those legislators. And one of the things that's exciting about this to me is that they're not shying away from electoral politics the way a lot of the technocratic folks do. It's too scary for them. They don't want to jeopardize their 501c3 status, et cetera, so they want to write another white paper. No. We have to win this battle in the neighborhoods. We have to show that we have the tools for making these communities safer. We have a process in mind. We have some priorities, some principles that guide this activity, and that draw to the fore the fundamental contradictions of what's being offered to us. And I'll tell you, they've had one victory already. The city of Salinas went out and got a federal Department of Justice grant to pay for more school police. And they're like, see, it's free money, of course. Well, how can you say no to this? Where do they want to put the school police? In the elementary schools. Why? Well, this is actually the very origins of school policing were in elementary schools, not in high schools where there are fights and other problems. Why? Because it's not about public safety. It's about the legitimation of authoritarian solutions to our community problems. They want to inculcate kids with the idea that police are their friends, that police are their mentors, even though you could hire other people to be their friends and mentors. No, they want them to be police because it's about building the legitimacy of a totally corrupt approach. Well, they went out, organized in Salinas, and said no to this, and convinced the school trustees, their kind of school board, to say, we don't care if they're free, this is not what our kids need. Our kids need restorative justice programs, after school services, pathways to employment. This is what's gonna make the schools better. This is what's gonna make the community better. And I think groups like DSA are really well situated to be involved in these kinds of campaigns because it's the melding of electoral politics and issue-based campaign work. And I think this is the model that we need to be replicated. Thank you.
Panelist up here, we won't have anyone up at the podium because that would look weird. I'll make brief introductions. So of course, joining the panel, we'll have Alex. We'll also have Chris Harris, who many of you will recognize, formerly of Fashion Leadership, currently of Just Liberty, and involved in virtually every criminal justice issue that I've worked on locally. Sukyi, who is one of the two most visible people in Austin Justice Coalition, one of the two people that I go to most often to ask questions about local criminal justice issues. We have Paula, who is, my understanding, has been in this game much, much longer than actually almost as long as I've been in Austin, particularly on these kind of. And then finally, Franklin, who is exactly the kind of insert a campaign to prove that, yeah, you can knock doors and get people to vote for abolitionists, which is great. As we all know, a bunch of us in Austin DSA tried to do a similar thing locally. Not as much success. I'll come down here in a second and grab one of those microphones, and we'll just go into the questions. So we'll have some pre-prepared questions, and then we'll go to questions from the audience. So for general format, we'll be passing it along this way. We'll go to general questions, and when we get to questions from the audience, we'll just let us know if it's a general question or a specific number. So one of the reasons why we had a larger panel rather than just Alex up is because so much of what happens in criminal justice is local and is influenced by very hyper-local decision-makers, district attorneys, city council members, county commissioner chairs, etc. And there's been a lot. When I joined Austin DSA last year, a large coalition, primarily grassroots leadership, the Austin Justice Coalition, had just pressured the city into not accepting what I consider one of the worst police contracts in the country, right? And that went, what was the final count? About 300 something days with no contract. In that same period of time, we got the Freedom Cities policies passed, and you know, a lot of information came out. Like we got the audit showing that we were one of the worst cities in the country to be a mentally ill person having someone call the police for you. So there's a reason why I thought it was important to have people who are local working locally on these issues here to answer questions. Also, so that like we have people who would actually be able to answer them instead of whatever comes off the top of my head. let's go ahead and get started. To just kind of start with that that local framing. part of what constrains, you know, the kind of work we can do on incarceration and policing is the state that we're in. You know, most incarceration are people in jail for state offenses. I guess what I'd be asking the panel, in what ways do you think the state that we're in a particular political coalition of our state, how conservative the legislature is, et cetera, constrains what's possible and what kind of tactics we have to use when dealing with mass incarceration and kind of putting forward these emancipatory visions? Well, these last words.
Let's start down there.
Okay. Everyone, yeah, Chris Harris here. Yeah, that's a great question. When I'm working at the district a lot, thinking about on a day-to-day basis. I think that given the constraints that are going to as far as they're willing to raise that attended by the state, what it does is it reinforces the need for us to really have more of a diversity framework. About police and prisons. There's no new money to create the programs, the services, things that we use in our community. Then we have to take that money from the existing institutions. And so that means it's not just not hiring, it's not replacing people who retire. That means not just not creating that new jail, but figuring out how we can actually incarcerate on the outside so they're not hire people, recruit people after attrition that hurt. And so really, I think it puts the onus on us to show the waste that's there with those institutions and the opportunities that exist for us to kind of simultaneously divest from those investments.
Work at the Capitol quite a bit and alongside just Liberty here. It's certainly, you know, the state of our state is hyper red. And you know, what's interesting is that we're kind of in ground zero for any kind of change. If it happens here, the rest of the countries think that it could possibly happen there too. So often people who are doing work here, like as soon as our last president got into office, they started cherry-picking us out of Texas because they're like, you don't know what to do in this, what's happening in the country. But y'all do because you've been doing it for so long. So what we know here makes us experts to the rest of the country. But I think that, you know, there's a certain amount of boldness that has to go along with going up to that Capitol. We have people here in the audience and the crowd who are from our legislative team who have been trained to go up there and who have been trained to go into Republican offices and to talk directly to whether if the legislators there or is their staffer, and to share with them, like to inform them and to instruct them. Even we write bills all the time, and it's an interesting and it can be a difficult method for change, but it does work. I would say in our last legislative session, we worked on 50 bills and 25 of them were passed. We helped. They weren't all bills that we created, but this legislative session was actually, it emboldened us. It really did when you have those types of successes. So there are opportunities. I think it's also because they didn't see us coming. They don't expect us to walk into their office and be as informed as we are and to know how to speak to them, which is a strange thing, because they do speak a different language. They come from a different place. And if you weirdly get into that ideology, however it makes you feel, you start to understand what works for them. And I'm not going to talk much longer, but you know, there is a certain amount of manipulation and subversiveness into doing this kind of work in this kind of situation.
Paula Rojas, and I think originally I was asked to be on this panel based on work that I did years ago around alternatives to policing. So I can just say a snippet of that and then the connection to the state of our state and what's relevant here and now. So I think the main thing is reading the conditions of what's possible, how the relations of power are working here and now versus in any situation. For me, in 1996 to 2006, I was part of an organization, Young Women of Color, in Brooklyn, called Sister to Sister, where we realized that the police was not reformable and that all the organizing that was being done, police brutality, which there was a lot of work happening back then in New York, that was lacking kind of an intersectional gendered analysis, which is what we brought, but also was very much focused on reforming the police as it was. And what we found was it wasn't reformable. There was no, we could have won reforms, but for the sake of what? So instead, our organizing was about creating alternatives to policing where we divested completely in a territory testing experiment, something called Sisters Liberated Ground, which was a physical territory where we would not turn to the police for any type of problem, violent or not. And we started to build that kind of people power and consciousness over years until we were able to actually practice it in a neighborhood. It was a small place. I can tell you more about that if you're interested. But I think how that speaks to where we are right now here in Texas, how I read the conditions is that working on the state level isn't the smartest thing for us to do. Yes, we can win reforms on the state level, but the kinds of reforms that make sense around policing, if any, are non-reformist reforms, right? Because the police is not reformable. So therefore, if some people can be putting their energy on those fronts, but we're not actually going to impact how policed our communities are, I would say, on a state level right now. I think it's more strategic. That's what I've been a part of now with other folks here in Austin who are here, who I think maybe should be sitting in my chair instead of me. I'm part of a coalition called Communities of Color United for Racial Justice, CCU. For the last 4 to 5 years, we've been working on city government in the city budget. And so what's clear there is, I don't know if y'all know, but the city of Austin has a hugely inflated police budget, which is now the case across the country. And since 9/11, even more in all city governments. But it's outrageous here in the city where we have, we're a small city, low crime rate, and we have this huge part of our city budget that goes to policing. And in public health, we're underfunded compared to peer cities, right, where this liberal bastion. But we don't even have a decent public health budget in Austin. Low-income housing, we're severely underfunded, and it's outrageous. What we call affordable housing in Austin is for people who are quite well off. I would say it's a racket of developers. It's called affordable housing. And so the non-reformist reform, I would say, for policing right now would be, how do we take away money from that part of the budget and put it into these other areas, such as public health, low-income housing, after-school programs, et cetera. We have a 10-month platform. I can tell you about it. That feels like it's something that, at the same time, has been winnable, removable. We do have enough organizing muscle for that. We're not just reinforcing the police and legitimizing with more body cameras and other things that we know are not the solution.
Certainly, I know conservative the state can be. For 10 years before my current gig, I was a criminal defense lawyer in private practice, and I tried cases all over the state, talking to juries, picking juries in places like Bell County, that has a statue of a slain police officer as the entrance of the courthouse. It's, I understand, right? And yet, it's not so daunting, right? If we look at where the power is and how we can use it. In my case in Houston, I never was doing there was this lawsuit, right? There was a federal court lawsuit, and so that's kind of one node of power, right? Federal courts are really good at disrupting kind of existing systems, right? But they're not really good at implementing and overseeing and following through, right? It takes political action to do that, right? And I think that a big liberal strategic problem has been over-reliance on the federal courts to do that long-term implementation, right? I mean, look at school integration, which is a complete failure, right? Because the political politics, you know, Brown versus the federal courts didn't do it, right? Not successfully. So seeing that this federal lawsuit came in and disrupted the bail system in Harris County starting about a couple of years ago, that's one way that to kind of get power in a red place, right, or in a blue spot in a red place, because not just Austin is, Houston is too. Look at that. Texas is one of the only state, you know, there's a lot of power in electing judges and even partisan judicial elections. Everyone likes to say that partisan judicial elections are bad. Why? Right? I mean, bad because the Democratic Party is bad, right? But like, you know, and they usually pick the people. But the thing is that like, there's something a little more real about it, right? Because I mean, judges are not these apolitical actors, right? I mean, they are, I mean, politics is the way we decide about how we live together, right? And of course, judges are political actors making political decisions, right? And so running as partisan, on a partisan ballot actually is somewhat more honest, right? And so, and if you look at that, we elect all of our judges in Texas, right? And these have real implications for the community work that we do, right? The Court of Appeals, I think, shut down, the plastic bag ban, right? I mean, these Republicans in the Court of Appeals are always knocking stuff down. So there's real power in this. And at the trial court level, right, there's a real opportunity to like implement the will of the people in individual cases on an individual basis, right? Because when it comes to the about 3,500 cases or so that pass in front of my court per year, I'm the final word, right, on what happens. And it doesn't matter how red the state is, right? What I say goes about the way the police conduct themselves. And that's really something. And so I think that it's a red place overall, right? And if you're storming the castle, right, down here. But there are these nodes of power that we can get into and really wedge a lot of change into. So, oh hi, I'm Franklin Bynum. I'm the judge of Harris County Criminal Court number 8.
Legislative victories and electoral victories are a symptom of our success, not the goal of our success in a sense. You know, there's different ways of thinking about this. One, or there are different models for achieving things in that realm. One is, well, we've got great arguments and we're going to create some efficiencies and, you know, there's a kind of technocratic reason to play around with the parole process and some pretrial diversion. Then there's, well, we've got a vision and we want to do community mobilizing, and one of those visions is a kind of alternative legislative framework for thinking about the criminal justice system. So yeah, we've got bills and we've got sponsors and we've got some hearings, but the purpose of that is to invigorate the mobilization process. And then we are making tremendous progress on the ground in creating new logics and new political priorities, and they're passing legislation because they're scared as shit of us, right? And it's that third model we want to be in, right? We got, because the other, especially the first one, is going to be always vulnerable to immediate rollback because we're not in a position to defend it. So when we've done the organizing on the ground, when we've created new logics and new political paradigms, the legislation, the electoral victories, I think will follow from that.
So because I wrote my notes out of order, we'll go back to previous question. So kind of going back to the kind of work that each of you, and of course this will be one route, so I'm going to say, going through the talk or just things you may have known about this work, what is something about the presentation that speaks to some element of your own personal work that you'd like to illuminate? This will also be a way to hopefully get the rest of you to know our panel a little bit more.
We can bounce back and forth.
So oh, yeah,
if,
well,
if you want,
yeah,
you know, it's like it's you know. So it's you don't want me first. So you know, I have a. If you ever come to Houston, please be my guest in my court.
I took my seven-year-old.
Yeah, it's amazing. You know, I'm finding a probable cause. I'm telling people to leave. I'm sending to jail. It's great, right? I mean, there's really nothing like it, right? But in the back, I have an office, and we're in this post-Harvey temporary quarters, and I have a couple copies of Alex's book, and I'm always telling people to go. It's my lending library, right? And I also have a pretty, like, a panoramic view of the jail complex from my office. And when I talk about Alex's book in my office, people would come in and want to talk to me about, you know, people come in and ask, like, prosecutors will, be like, is it true you're a prison abolitionist? Like, yeah. Let's just tell you what it means, right? And they're like, oh, that makes a lot of sense. And the thing is that, like, the way Alex puts it does make a lot of sense to a lot of people, right? And the part of it is that we start with the world that we have, you know? We start with the material circumstances that we have, which should be like really second nature to leftists, right? That we are, you know, constrained by our material conditions, right? And historical material conditions. We are. And so that's where we start, right? We don't start at like looking at the panoramic view of the jail and saying, well, you know, let me just wave my arm and make all this disappear, right? That's not possible. What is possible is expanding people's imagination by running things differently, right? And by showing people a different way, actually putting a different way into action every day. And I was just telling Alex before, right, we did this a couple months ago, right? And every time I speak about anything, right, it's in the context of the previous week, right? And like, the more I do what I do, the more I'm able to do it. Right, and so it is for all of us. So you know, how the practicality and the acknowledment of the present conditions and the acceptance of them, using them as a starting point, is something that is what I love so much about Alex's work.
The talk, I felt like it helps obviously to center this conversation and to ground it. I particularly liked hearing about your discussion, kind of your final remarks about political accountability, and I too find that is of utmost importance. You know, we know that from the beginning it all trickled up and then back down. So we started out with some very decisive moments about the construct of our country and what was the most important and who was the most important. And, you know, our laws dictated from there on till, you know, till now. You know, we know that, you know, even as the 13th Amendment goes, you know, slavery never ended, you know, and we went straight from that into Jim Crow laws and black codes and pig laws and all kinds of things to help usher us back into the mode of slavery. So I do feel that political accountability is important. And I think that also comes from an interdisciplinary group, an effort to bring that to life. They'll listen, I feel, if everybody comes to the table. So that was one of our biggest and best results from our police accountability, from our contract fight, was when it came to the day of the vote at City Council, we had every type of person of every type of age and every type of background come to the City Hall that day and state their lack of support for the police contracts. And I think that it was an eye-opening occasion for the City Council, and it also gave them the political will, the ability to say no, because they knew that every people came from their areas. So there was a distinct effort on our parts and our coalition's part to go to each district and to compel people who live in each council member's district to go and say, I live in district 2, 3, whatever it was. It's here's my vision of public safety. And it was a large part in forming and empowering the community. But that was a moment where community-led reform pushed back and up and into what we have now in terms of our contract, which hugely influenced what we have now with our independent police oversight body. So much happened because of the will of the people to enact political accountability. So I really did feel like that was something important and that we should very much embrace. And, you know, DSA was certainly there that day. And I know that there were so many boots on the ground throughout that effort. And, you know, that's, it took all of us to make that happen. And it will continue to at whatever level we're working at, or, you know, even working with school boards on up to, you know, state level here or beyond. So I appreciate it.
Yes. So I read about the book, I think, right before it came out and got around that. And I would say it definitely has been something that has helped, you know, I think, center some of my efforts, right? Because it is easy to get into the nitty gritty, to the wonkiness of it. I do a lot of data analysis as well. So, you know, I got my MBA in a spreadsheet, some number of hours of the day. And you come up from that, it's easy to just see the whole system like that matrix, you know, green, flowing down, green, and not really lose sight of, you know, I would say less so the people, but more just the overarching goals that you're trying to reach with it. Each individual fight, each individual policy change has to be part of a broader strategy that leads to ultimately the goal that you have, and police abolition is one of those goals for me. And so I've tried to view each thing that I've worked on at within that lens of one chipping away at the mission of police and the things that they have to do, right? Because as you said, you know, they. One, our politicians find it easy to invest in them over and over as a solution for any of the problems that we face. It's the easiest thing to do without people. But then two, it's something that the police are actively fighting for. They while some of them will say privately, you know, we get asked to do too much, their leadership is constantly actively trying to ensure that they are the response to everything. During the conversations last year about our new police chief, Brian Manley, where we did not have a national search and he was hired without any competition, which is very unfortunate, he repeatedly brought up his vision for policing. And he said that he wanted his police to focus more on quality of life concerns. And this, to me, is exactly the problem. We don't need police. We don't need them to help with these small quality of life concerns that he actively wants to organize his reign as police chief going on. So one for me is chipping away at that mission, and so ultimately we can justify rolling back and divesting from the police. And on that note, you know, I think that I agree with you on Harvey Powell that the bulk of the work is at the local level for that purpose. That is where the investments in the police are overwhelmingly made. That said, I will put in a brief pitch to say that you can help to chip away at the state level. One of the things that we did last year, what was mentioned, a lot of groups and a lot of folks in this room helped with that effort, with the Freedom City policy, which stopped police arrests for almost all citable offenses, so all Class C's and all low-level B's and A's, marijuana and DWI. The preliminary reports haven't been released, but they're estimated to have cut arrests by 15% in year over year in a 6-month period. So, you know. Not yet. Now the full reports haven't been released yet, but that's the initial indications of things. So May 1st, they'll come out. We can vet them all and get into the group. But those are the sorts of things that we can take to the city leadership and say, look, you know, we don't have an issue. Crime didn't go anywhere. Nothing changed on the ground. But your folks are arresting a lot more people. Like, there's thousands of people now that haven't had the burden of an arrest, haven't had the burden of having to post bail and hire a lawyer and find child care and find help, care for an elderly relative, even for the few hours that they may have been in jail, or potentially days or weeks, depending on whether or not they're able to get out. So those things help us in these future budget fights. And there's an opportunity that we have right now at the state level to do that. I don't know if we'll get it done. And I don't like how the state politics function. I don't like the theory of change that you operate under at the state level. But there is an opportunity to creep away, to chip away at that mission. So I hope that we can get that. And then, you know, I think the other big thing is in addition to chipping away at the mission, is to really just the whole hearts and minds element. Right, to making people, it's also to helping build and organize around alternatives, right? Ultimately, that can replace. So, you know, there's a lot of little hanging fruit things that they're doing now that they have no business doing, that we don't need them for, that there's nothing there. But and there are areas where there are needs. We actually do have needs. And how do we get replacement? How do we get the alternatives that are there? And I think there are a lot of good people in this room doing work on that front. Working to build those alternatives for violence, for substances, for mental health issues. And I think those are the sort of combined efforts that we really need to be going on. It's chip away with the things that we know that they don't, that no one, we don't need any intervention for. And then where we do need help, let's create the alternatives to help provide that so that we're ready. You know, we're ready to move it out.
So I also really appreciated, Alex, your remarks and some, I haven't read the whole book, but from what I've gathered, your recognition, what Sukyi was talking about, of the kind of historic root causes of this and many other problems we have in this country, right? So I appreciate you pulling us back to the beginning. Because we're not going to figure out how to solve it unless we really look at the history and kind of connect the dots. So I guess for me, thinking about that as an abolitionist, still understanding that the policing and prisons are not the fundamental problem here, right? It's just one small piece of a much larger problem of this country. I mean, we are not in the United States, the wealthiest country by far in the world, because we are a place of smarter, more hardworking people. That's not how we became the wealthiest country in the world, but how we became the wealthiest by far country in the world is at the expense of the human bodies and land historically, right? And policing policing is inextricably linked to that in this country. Not that policing isn't fucked up in other countries too. I'm from Chile, and I can tell you everyone, by the time you can say a word, knows your instincts are very, we have really good instincts about how the police has been part of kind of the state apparatus of control and torture, you know, always. So it's not just here. But there's a very particular thing in this country of how policing is able to maintain the three-headed monster, right? That we, that white supremacy and capitalism and patriarchy that are, it's not just that it's a three-headed monster, but that we live in the brain of that monster, right? The US, us people are in that, the brain of that monster. And that's a very different reality than humans anywhere else on the planet. So I think for me, it's important to think about it in a global context and why worse, I would say, I'm a popular educator, so I was trained in that. I don't know if any of y'all know about popular education, geared up to the oppressed. That what one of the fundamental problems we have here is the cop in the head, you know, from the get, before we even think about what's winnable, what's a real non-reformist reform, we are all, because we live in the brain of the monster of the world, right? Unlike everybody else, we have a cop in the head that's so intense that though I agree that how to solve it is kind of clear, our imaginations are very, very stifled, especially only lived in this reality of the wealthiest place in the world at the expense of every other human on the planet, that it's hard to be expansive enough and willing to take the risks, including material risks, needed in order to really transform the situation, I would say. So that's one, to me, that's more of a fundamental problem that we're grappling with. Within that, if we look at what's happening right now, right here, I would say, Austin, once we became not an at-large city council as we were until just a few years ago, people know that now we have geographic opportunity districts, 10 districts. A lot of people fought hard for that. I mean, this is a small city, y'all, a very wealthy, small city. It's not that hard. In New York, why we developed liberated territories was we couldn't, we didn't have a handle, there wasn't a way. But here, I think there is a way. The districts are relatively small. The city council member, one of them is a member of DSA, right? I mean, these are people who we can literally hold by the neck if we need to. And we in terms of organizing what is possible and doable in the city, I think we're actually in a pretty good place compared to most around the country. And I would say I'm surprised that we haven't thought about those things before. No one had really thought about how overfunded our police was until recently. We didn't even know. All you have to do is look at the numbers. It wasn't like this 25 years ago. It kind of crept up. And we know it's real estate developers, lobby, RICA, and the police association lobby. These are powerful forces that keep our so-called progressive city government in check. But it wouldn't take that much to destabilize that kind of status quo, I would say.
I wanted to say one thing about this history question. So we typically hear in spaces like this a lot of talk about the role of slave patrols in the formation of American policing. And of course, that's very important, and I talk about that history very concretely in the book. But in a place like Texas, there's a different history of policing that's rooted in colonialism, not slavery. And I took my 11-year-old, who's here tonight, to the Alamo the other day, because I spoke in San Antonio, and I'm explaining to her the history of that, and she's like, wait a second, none of these were the good guys. And I'm like, exactly, now you're the Texas Rangers, right, were the earliest form of policing in Texas, whose primary mission was the extermination of the indigenous population, the driving out of historic Mexican and Spanish landholders south of the border to make way for white settlement, and then the suppression of the rights of Latinos to vote, to access public services, etc. But they were turned into national heroes. Movies were made. The main history, the second edition came out, Lyndon Baines Johnson wrote the foreword, right? This is our history, the Alamo, the Texas Rangers, which of course is just another form of colonialism.
Sorry, I agree, yes, but I mean, the interesting thing about Texas is also the Texas Rangers also played a role in terrorizing the black community,
yes,
and making sure that there wasn't black brown solidarity, right? That was something that we have accounts of. So as was, I would say it's both. It's these deep roots of both colonialism and enslavement of humans, and how that played out is now the direct result of today.
So I will move on to the next question, despite noting that we could definitely spend the next hour talking about how uniquely shitty Texas is, of expansion of slavery, how the Civil War hadn't happened, Texas would be one of the primary reasons that slavery spread to every other state, as well as being the get-out-of-jail-free card for slaveholders who are under the neck of debt. Back to the order of the day. So just before I joined DSA, one of the things that had happened was the rejection of the police contract. It was one of the reasons why I decided to finally become politically active again. And for people who aren't very well situated in how bad things were before, Paul and a few others had noted the size of our budget. Correct me if I'm wrong, Chris and Sukyi, I think it was around 41%. Of the total discretionary city budget goes to policing and general budget, that's right. And we had one of the worst contracts in the state. So kind of putting together information. So I guess the question there would be, first, if one or both of you could just give some context on just how bad things were, and for the rest of the panel, what the rejection of that and, you know, the kind of things that happened over the next year as a consequence of that, what it means in terms of what opportunities are opening up at the local level for continued criminal justice organizing, you know, what things have changed in your mind as a consequence of those changes.
I'll start first and hand it off to Chris. We like to wrap together. So our meet for our police agreement started back in 2000, and back then it was created with the idea that you would have the police joining a union and having this agreement that would also include civilian oversight. And so back then there was a working group, and they had these brilliant ideas about their vision for civilian oversight and accountability and how that would be baked into this contract. The contract back then went into secret closed door meetings, and when it came out the other end, it looked pretty much what it looked like in 2017 when they started up the new conversations, the new negotiations. They had stripped totally civilian oversight. They included this body called, the Office of the Police Monitor, and they had a civilian oversight, citizen oversight body, basically. But it was a toothless entity, so that if you were to go and make a complaint, you might be able to go to an oversight hearing or a day and voice your complaint. There was nothing that the body could do except for just hear you and say, we're sorry that this happened to you. They could only offer recommendations for critical incidents, and even those were typically unheard. So when we came in back in 2017, actually a little bit before that, we came out with a better reform more strategy and saying, look, APD, you're asking for $13 million in 2016's budget. How about no? How about, first of all, you do a whole lot better. Here's a host of things that you could do. And one of those was their contract. So make it that the public has a seat at that table. And the city council at that point put a budget writer saying, hey, EPD, we kind of agree with these guys. Come back in a year, we'll talk about those costs. We'll talk about that money if you've been working and doing these types of reforms, these types of changes. And so we went to every meeting of the police negotiation through 2017, because also on the national level, Austin ranks from the Campaign Zero's database. They collated around 80 different police contracts from around the country, and across all six of their metrics, Austin failed, along with only six other police contracts. You know, the fact that police could look at all of the evidence, 48 hours, you know, had 48 hours of, you know, I would tell officer friendly, look, someone made a complaint or, you know, something's happened. Here's all everything that they're complaining about. Go ahead and look at it and we'll talk about it and, you know, work on what you should be saying, what this narrative is going to be. They had, you know, an extensive amount of time for complaints to be made, or if a complaint wasn't made by a certain amount of time, then it would just go away. There was nothing the police chief could do to discipline officers. And we saw that continuously. Well, if I'm traumatized over something terrible that's happened to me and I sit on it for a couple years and I've worked through my trauma as much as I can, and then like I feel like a certain place I can say something about this, it's like, sorry, 2 years ago? Exactly. So there were so many issues with that police contract that on the national lens were quite known as well. So we had a lot of ammo going into this whole campaign. So, I mean, it was as bad as it can get in terms of police contracts. And, you know, we knew that policy-wise, whatever we were doing on the front end, if there was no discipline on the back end, then it didn't matter. It didn't mean shit. Like, it's like, how do you make sure that the work you're doing over here is going to have results on the end? So that's kind of the lens of where we went into that contract fight. And it took, again, an immense amount of working in coalition. And yeah, things were bad. And I will pass it over.
So, you know, I was really new in his work at that point. Jumped in. I think on the strength of one being really, really upset about police brutality, obviously, around the country, and having been that way for years, and feeling really hopeless about, you know, the about opportunities to in fact change, and then two, you know, having a really severe distrust in the criminal legal systems in general, and that applies to every single person, and that includes police. And so, for me, I don't believe that the criminal legal system offers a path for real justice for our communities and for people, and that includes people accused of crimes, and that includes police officers. And so, the best way to ensure accountability that I can see for police was through their labor agreement. By ensuring that bad police could not be police anymore. Let's just keep them out of their jobs. And at minimum, then there's one more really horrible, violent person out of the police force. As I dove more and more into the campaign and we kind of watched it play out, obviously I think my own knowledge and about the terms of it, what I really came to see was opportunities that it provided in two ways. One is, again, as it relates to divestment, right? Over that original deal that the police struck with the city back in 2000-2001 was a deal for money. The police at that time were led by what was considered a very progressive union president. And he had this bright idea, you know, we get a big raise if we agree to one of these police oversight things. You know, they're not really going to. And we'll get a big raise. So let's do that. And, you know, he had to drag his own police force along with them because many of them were afraid that it might do something. But he knew better. And so he was able to manipulate the process, make sure it was toothless, and he got a $40 million immediate raise, right? And this is right around that time frame that Paula was talking about. And so, obviously, the police contract also created opportunity for us to decrease the amount that we're actually investing in police, and again, open up opportunities for us to, for reinvestment in community and in real alternatives to police. And so I would say that, and then secondarily, that provided opportunities for us to get more transparency. So yes, accountability. Yes, I want to see bad cops fired. Yes, because we can actually decrease the amount our city invests in policing and again, create opportunities. And we've done that. Now the next fight is here, right? Now is the fight for those alternatives. And then three, the opportunity to get more transparency through the police. And again, this is a fight that just sets up more fights, right? Because once we know what's going on, what we can do is we can organize, right? What has really galvanized the community and the nation, the world around police accountability issues because these videos keep coming out, because of technology and people putting out the videos. And people seeing the videos, obviously there are being more people engaged in sharing them and doing all that. There's a lot of work on the ground as well, but it's very much about the transparency of what they're doing. And once we can get more of that information out there, once we can see more of the videos, then we can galvanize more and more people to this cause, to understanding this from our perspective, and get people involved in this movement again to divest from the police and free alternatives. And so, with the contract, basically, we got the council to unanimously vote it down, which meant they were without a contract for almost a year. During that process, they didn't give any of the stipends or the bonuses that they had agreed to through the course of their previous contract negotiations. And that saved the city somewhere in the neighborhood of $10 million last year. So then the contract that was ultimately agreed to, very much an improvement over the agreement that was turned down in 2017. Did it go far enough? Does it mean we're going to have a fully accountable, transparent police force? But what it did come in with was $40 million cheaper than the deal that was turned down in 2017. So we're talking about collectively almost $50 million pulled out of the police force over a five-year period, right, through this campaign. And now opportunities, right, to invest that money into something else. And so, CCU folks have been at City Hall on this budget game for a long time. They put together some amazing proposals, and I think, AJC and other groups have been doing it as well. And I think we've really got to get behind some of these now to really be galvanized community to say, now's the time to invest in these alternatives. This is what actually is going to help us. And so let's create these, let's continue to divest, and let's move on. And I think the last thing I'll say about this is just that I think what it's enabled the people to see, the media to see, and the people in power to see is that the police union does not have the near political power that they used to have in our community. You can stand up to them, you can win a re-election, you can be like Ann Kitchen and not even have a voter. They can't even find someone that's going to run against you. So there's a real opportunities. Now we have to hold those people to it, right? Like, look, you stood up before and that worked out fine. So let's keep doing that, right? And like, you got to keep standing up. You got to keep investing in the community. You got to keep divesting.
I would add to that because I agree with what y'all are saying is I think maybe our challenges in criminal justice organizing here locally are more the bigger challenges in organizing, I would say, in Austin. How I see it is that there's a lot of activism, but there's not a lot of organizing. And that feels very different than in other places around the country. So part of it maybe is because it's a college town, maybe because like a hip place to live, I don't know, but there's lots of activism. Just every night there's like, I don't know how many of these forums going on that you gotta pick which one you go to, where you get to like grow your head even bigger with information and know everything about everything. But that doesn't translate into any concrete change in any real person's life. You know what I mean? And that's what I think is missing. Organizing is very different than activism, or, you know, in the work of organizing, whatever we do, every single action, small or big, public or private, the lens is, how are we using it to build our power more? How are we using whatever it is to build power, meaning numbers of people, but also consciousness of people? And the third, very important for the way that I see organizing, is prioritizing folks who are most directly impacted by whatever it is we're organizing about, right? Which is also a difference between activism and organizing. In organizing, we want to center the leadership of people who are most in feeling the brunt of the oppression, right? We want to support that leadership, amplify that leadership, and for those that have more access or resources, we want to be able to funnel those in that way. So ultimately, I think it's not, you know, these are all the work on the police contract, our work, even on the budget, right? This isn't the real work, right? These are steps, non-reformist reforms that can help us move and kind of take the boot off, you know, a little bit from the neck. But ultimately, it is about building power, right? Building people power, building consciousness and people power, as our longer term vision of work that we need to be doing right now to build a more just and loving world. And so I think any opportunity we can to use the organizing as how I think about it is theater, you know, because it's not, like Alex was saying, the elections aren't really it. That's one theater, you know. The powerful social movements around the world that inspired me are the ones that know 900,000 people strong. On election day, they all go out and vote. You know, they vote the way they should vote, but that's one day. And the other 364 days of that year, they're organizing. You know what I mean? And I feel like here we're flipped, where it's like we're organizing for an election, as opposed to the election is one thing that at least each of us need to go and tick that box, you know, because we can. But that's not where we're going to make the change. So I think that what we're doing in the budget work, we'd love to have more people support it. If without that much people power, we do know that in the last 4 years, we've not been able to freeze APT budget, but we've been able to curb the growth of APT budget. Absolutely, we've heard that back. And we've kind of significantly increased public health, which was pathetically underfunded 4 years ago. We still have a long way to go. I don't know if y'all know that we were able to pass a resolution to create an equity office within the city that's supposed to have, that has a lens of racial equity in particular, looking at all the departments in the city, all the allocations. So it isn't just how much goes to parks versus how much goes to health, but pulling that apart, which parks in which part of town for which communities are getting the money and which ones aren't, which is happening in Austin, if y'all know. It's outrageous. If you see publicly funded city spaces and facilities where some parts of town have these country club looking public pools. Did you know this? And then other parts of town, we have pools that are pathetic, bathrooms that are disgusting, you know? These are the things that I think we can build around to really do those three things of organizing, which is build our numbers, build our consciousness, and center those most directly impacted. I think it's doable. I'm gonna ask the CCU people over here to raise your hand. Sorry, because I just want everyone else to know who they are. Higher, please, come on. And if you wanna talk to anybody, I think at this point, what we're thinking about is we're about to start the budget process this year, right now, this week, and it goes on for a good 6 months of kind of fighting for it, that we would love to be in conversation with DSA about how we might collaborate around this. And Zach, raise your hand, raise your hand. There's clipboards if you wanted to sign up to get on our list. Thank you, sorry about that.
Thank you, let me just say that people know what happened here. And it is inspiring other people in San Francisco and some other places. They're trying to launch similar campaigns of accountability around these union contracts. And it's important to keep in mind that a union contract is a contract between two parties, the police and the city. And it's these cities that sign these contracts that give all these extra protections and perks. So that as much as we want to hold the unions accountable for these inside deals, it's the other side that's also signing that piece of paper. The other thing I want to say is Austin is not unique in its 41% of the city budget going to policing and jails. This is a pervasive problem, and the Center for Popular Democracy has been working on this across the country, and they had a great report last year called Freedom to Thrive, right? Very good. Hold that up. And they are working with exactly these kinds of community-based efforts to identify where the money is going, because, of course, it's not always easy to even find that 41% number. They try to hide it. So we got to find that number, and then we've got to be crystal clear about all the harm that number causes versus all the good it could do.
I was going to not say anything because I'm not from around here, but I do want to say this. Something we just did in Harris County was the DA's office came and asked for about 100 new prosecutors, right? And the thing that's most difficult, and that was roundly rejected, right? Because we had a talk about the harm and everything. But what's tricky about Harris County, right, is that everyone in power is talking about being a reformer, right, including the DA who's asking for this expansion of the DA's office. She's like, well, I need these more prosecutors to, like, file fewer cases and, like, dismiss more cases, right? And so, like, a lot of the language of a lot of the language we're using is being co-opted, right, and saying, well, we need this. We need to expand the contract, you see, right? And you know, just to flag that as, like, you know, something that can be overcome and that we just did.
That's exactly what happened in New York, where the police department said we need 1,000 new officers so we can do community policing to respond to all the community concerns about the police.
they released a pretty big report here. They referred to every budget season. Over and over, exactly that. In order to do this,
we had a few more questions lined up, but our panelists have been giving very comprehensive responses. Yes. To make sure that the rest of you got to have some interaction. So we have a microphone over on the left-hand side there. If people would like to line up for any questions you may have, if you look like me, you should maybe let people who don't look like me get in front of you.
But Seneca, I like to talk so much. I might be up here for
wait, is that right, Brian?
No.
Hello, Stephanie Webb. So first off, love this panel. Love the panel of all the POC and all the white folks, because this is really how you build community. You recognize that everybody's in it. So my question is, recently we just heard that the Texas Supreme Court basically ruled that it's not a crime to have meetings behind closed doors and make decisions for you know, people who matter, i.e. the majority of society. And so I want to know how you think that's going to affect your activism, because obviously transparency is huge, and that's one of the main reasons why y'all have been so successful and been working so long. How do y'all think that's going to affect your activism in the future?
You're talking about them overturning part of the Texas Open Meetings Act? Yeah. So it's unclear how that's going to affect Austin in the short term. So basically, for those who don't know, elected officials are not able to gather in private
in any numbers that would allow them to make a decision where in secret, right? So there's 11 council members, so six of them can't get together in private and discuss city business at any time. Because if they did, they could theoretically come up with all the things they're going to do, then show up to the council dais and just do them without ever, without really engaging the community. And so obviously there's a lot of fear about what this ultimately is going to mean. There's also like real tricky ways that they can, you know, not all get together at once, but like one person talks to another and they talk to the next person and create basically this like daisy chain of secrecy and playing by it with that. And, you know, the existing rules have really helped advocates a lot because basically the council is limited to talking about one issue in a group of five or less. So only five of them could ever be in what's called a quorum where they could actually talk about these contract principles. Only five of them could ever talk about it. Now that's really powerful. They would only ever need one more person to come to their side to win a vote for council, but they could never know, right? They could never actually know that they had the whole majority. And so it allowed those of us who don't have those restrictions, who can talk to everybody, to have more knowledge, more information about where everybody was at, than a lot of times those folks have and their staffers would have. There's another element though. There's people that work for the city, right? And these folks have their own agendas, right? They have their own things they're trying to get done, which may or may not conform to community desires or desires of people in the council. And they have similar power under that system, right? They can talk to all the council members. They can talk to everybody. They can know everything that's going on. So, and so right now, the city people are saying Austin is not going to change. Austin's going to keep the previous interpretation of the Texas Meetings Act, what teeth that will have, how that will be enforced, given that they're not able to actually hold someone criminally liable for breaking it now is unclear, but the city people don't want to change the Texas Meetings Act because, again, they have power in that system as well. So so it'll be intriguing to see. There's definitely some fear about it, but I think probably they'll try to fix whatever the judge is going to like and get something back in place. So I'm not going to freak out this year.
Who are these city people you're referring to? City managers? Like, what are these positions of power?
Yeah, so Austin is a weak man system. So the city manager really runs the city from the administrative component, and all the city departments under the city manager, with the exception of just a few. And so they have, you know, the bureaucracy underneath the city manager, who ultimately get to do a lot of things on their own, and are the city people I'm talking about.
Yeah, hold on, sorry, I guess I didn't work back
here. I basically have two questions. The first one I'm directing at Alex. It's regarding earlier when we were discussing policing. You discussed a lot of different factors, but there's one very important factor that I think wasn't touched too much, and it's the issue of capitalism in policing. Essentially, capitalism leads into policing because the policing institution is meant as a way of protecting the interests of those with money, which is evidenced by the very laws that we live under. We see them as normal because we're indoctrinated into thinking that that's how things are supposed to be. Yet, I didn't hear a lot of discussion regarding what we should do to get people to understand from our framing exactly why policing as it exists is immoral. So that's my first question. What should we do in that regard?
Oh, okay. I'll take them one at a time. Okay. So I'm no fan of capitalism. You know, let's not make any mistakes about that. What I focus on is the ways in which policing exists to facilitate regimes of exploitation, of which capitalism is only one. So, for instance, we had colonialism without exactly modern capitalism. Policing facilitated the extermination of the indigenous population, expropriation of land, etc. That so, and also we've seen state socialism, other forms of government that also have horrible and abusive policing. So we want to be careful that whatever system we put in place is not based on exploitation of people. And while we don't exactly have, you know, slavery and colonialism in the domestic context today, what we have is a kind of neoliberal politics of deindustrialization and hyper-financialization that has produced this incredibly polarized economy of a very handful of extremely wealthy people at the top and then a massive underclass, which produces a different set of problems for the police to manage. Mass homelessness, mass untreated mental illness, mass involvement in black markets, and that's what police do today is manage those consequences of this particular form of capitalism we have today. So here's the tricky thing. Does that mean that we can't fix policing without ending capitalism? I think this is a, we have to be careful about that because this has produced in the past a kind of throw up your hands attitude about fixing the criminal justice system because we got to put all our energy into ending capitalism. I actually think that the way we heighten the contradictions around capitalism is in part through doing exactly the kind of community organizing that people are talking about up here, which is going into communities and saying, why can't we have affordable housing? Why can't we have adequate health care? Why can't we have decent schools? Now, to the extent that we can win advances on that, that builds our power, that makes our community better and stronger. And to the extent they won't give us those things, it points out the ultimately corrupt characteristics of this system and drives the contradictions that hopefully will lead to something better.
My second question was directed towards the entire panel. It would be essentially within the framing of policing as it exists today, we're starting to see rise to a more authoritarian police state in which everything we do is being surveilled. Is there any formal community-based counter that we can have to this? Because the issue of privacy isn't just an issue for those who may or may not be doing something wrong. It's also an issue for respecting the autonomy of the individual overall.
Yeah, I mean, we're being watched for sure. I mean, we're live streaming, so there's no secret about what's being said here and what's going on here. And they watch, I mean, for sure, you know, when there's a protest. Even some of the ones we've had, they're like, hey, we noticed you're having a protest. It's in our email. It was like, oh yeah, they're definitely aware and savvy to what we're doing. But, you know, it's also because in some ways we feed into it. You know, there's no way to build awareness around what we're doing and these important ideas that we're talking about without the aid of social media. I mean, word of mouth is great, but, you know, it can only go so far. We can always point someone back to this live stream and say, hey, watch this whole thing. You should catch it at minute 3.56 and catch this awesome thing that Chris said, you know. So there is that, and it is not a comfortable existence. And it's an interesting thing. It's very new. When even I was a young person, which is a long time ago, we did not have these privacy like issues necessarily. You know, we didn't have cell phones. I'm talking about a long time ago now. I did not grow up with a cell phone. So there was a certain point where we kind of agreed to this hyper visibility and this lack of privacy. So I don't know. Where do we draw the line between where we just turn off and not do a live stream and where we decide that it's too important not to? I don't know. I feel like the way things are headed, we just have to be as bold as we can, because if we almost oversaturate we build this narrative, you know, and if they start using it, not co-opting it, but actually using it, and it gets into their heads, like, it's hard to disprove something when everyone is talking about it, when it's a popular narrative. It's like, how can you not agree that racism is wrong? You know, like, why would you agree that this type of policing is okay when the consensus is growing that it is adverse to our human dignity and our basic rights? So, I mean, that's all I have to say about that. It's just, we really do live in this odd balance of non-privacy and just putting ourselves out there. But, I mean, I'm here for it. Like, I will take the rest of my life and just be like, every day, what can you really do?
What's your name? I think this is a really good question. Thank you. I guess to what I could add to what Sukyi's saying, I think it's a good and complicated question that we should be really, really wrestling with. I think that the nature of our organizing nowadays is too much depending on media, on social media, and kind of electronic versions of organizing. It's not just because I'm old school and I was younger, even before Sukyi was younger, but because I think there's some kind of laziness to that worries me. And that's separate from the question of surveillance, actually. You know, aside from the question of surveillance, I think that there's something lost in the belief that we are going to build power without more human full connections. And that it does kind of amplify activism versus organizing. You know what I mean? Where people are like, oh yeah, I'm woke about everything. I know everything about everything. And I read this and I know that, but you're not doing anything about it. So what, you know, so how is that changing anybody's life, material conditions for anyone? So I think that's part of the problem. How that's connected though to the surveillance question, I would say one, in this country, there's been surveillance for a long time, right? So COINTELPRO, et cetera, that's been going on for a long time. Now it's just a given that every single moment of your life, unless you have not only turned off your cell phone, but taken the battery out of it, you are on an open mic, right? All of us are 24/7. And that's a very different reality than we had, you know, even 15 years ago. So what does that mean? I think we read the conditions. This is the conditions of life we're living in right now. So I would say the vast majority of our organizing needs to be public, needs to be out. We need to assume that we're always on a mic, like Sukyi's saying, that they're always watching us, because that's just being smart. That's the conditions of life that we live in right now in this moment. And there can be space for some private type of organization, conversation, learning, connection, where we intentionally make decisions to not be on an open mic, right? And I think that there's a lot of, we can learn from, I'm in touch still with social movements in other countries who are wrestling with these questions and developing practices and protocols for that other part of their work, which I think is worth discussing.
Yeah, Julian, thanks for the question. The short answer is no. I don't know of any active anti-surveillance movements going on. I'm the guy not on Facebook. But I will say that, one kind of like real area of overlap that is something that is being talked about, there is no movement around, is around the issue of police on body cameras, right? So, these are tools that obviously many in the police accountability and Black Lives Matter movement have championed as things that we should wear. And I think that the reality has kind of come into, the reality of those that were skeptical of that has come to pass, which is that that we don't get to see the videos unless they show that an officer didn't do anything, and otherwise they get to use them as they wish, And obviously, as they're wearing them all the time, that means they're inside of our homes, they're inside of our communities, they're inside of our schools. And so now they are basically a new tool of surveillance for the police. I struggle with this mightily in terms of how we proceed from here, given that the millions have been invested, the work is, the body cams are there. And where I sit now is that it's two things. One is that we need the footage. If they're going to wear them, they're going to have them, then we have to have the footage. And so there's a movement currently. There should be a public sort of working group convened shortly that will be tasked with helping to craft a new policy locally to about public release of body cam footage. They're not releasing it all here. It is straight up on. Now, Texas law gives them the ability to kind of take that interpretation, but it is just an interpretation. They can interpret it differently, and it's our job to give them that interpretation. Secondarily, I think that we need to be putting as many constraints on and requirements to their handling of the footage, how they process it, everything, because we've actually started to see, especially in smaller communities, but I do think that it's possible in bigger communities, that they have realized that the investment isn't worth it because it's not changing police behavior. It's not leading to less lawsuits. It's not doing any of the things they said it was going to do as far as police accountability. The public isn't happy because we're not seeing the footage, but now they've got to have all this data storage. They've got to have all these people to respond to public information requests. They've got to be scrubbing the video. They've got to be deleting it. They've got to be doing all these things. And so the more that we can add on to those requirements, the more that we can create costs for communities so that they decide, you know what, we actually don't want these anymore. And that started to happen, and I think we should continue to push back.
Let me just say on the body cams, what I've written is that, maybe we could pass this mic on to the next person while I just quickly say, I've said that if we can't get rid of them, the police should not have control of the footage at all. And the other thing is, two groups who are doing this work, that's the Stop LAPD Spying Coalition, which is really outstanding, and the other is the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and they have a kind of organizing arm as well, and they're doing great public education around how to protect your social media and things like that.
Hey, y'all. So this is kind of a tough question, but my family has a lot of domestic violence history in it, and whenever I was young, when we were kids, like when my mom would call the cops on my dad, they would show up and they would ask her, you know, ma'am, do you want us to arrest this man? And she would always say no, because she didn't want her kids to see their dad that, you know, get taken away in handcuffs. And so I kind of grew up knowing that the cops weren't really a good resource for people in abusive situations and in violent situations. But that's often used as an argument for why we do need the police, right? Like how, you know, we can't get rid of the police because then who are women going to call? Or who are victims going to call? Usually without recognizing that the police don't really help that much, and a lot of the times they harm the people who call them for help. So I guess I'm really excited, you know, about the work that you did, and just now sort of having this conversation, you know, what sort of alternatives to policing could exist for people like my mama, so that people in her situation could actually get help, you know, anything on that would be great.
Before I pass this on, I just want to make one recommendation, which is to look at Beth Ritchie's book, Arrested Justice. It's a very important framework for thinking.
Definitely, yeah. So I think that's also a great question, and thank you for sharing. Appreciate it. I think a few things can help us think about this. One is that before in the U.S., before we criminalized domestic violence, there was a movement against domestic violence, and it was powerful, right? And it was part of kind of a feminist movement that was building and organizing safe houses and safe spaces and ways of dealing with domestic violence. What happened is that it turned into an industry, right? A nonprofit industry. And the thought then, because it wasn't really intersectional as it should have been, there wasn't a good race cut to the work, was missing, where they thought the win after all this work over years was, we can make it a crime. Let's make domestic violence a crime. That's how we're gonna win, right? You could have asked other people about that who would have told you, nah, that's not gonna help us. But that is what then that whole kind of feminist movement that turned into a nonprofit industry of what is now the domestic violence and sexual assault industry. It's huge in this country, how much money is pumped into it. And it is absolutely in cahoots with policing. And it's increasing criminalization, increasing arrests, not just of perpetrators, but also people who call get arrested, often women of color. It's a huge problem. CPS gets called in, children get taken out. So that's what it's turned into. But it wasn't always the case here, and it's not that long ago where we turned to other methods of dealing with violence, domestic violence, that was not the police. So one is we have to remember that, and two is I don't know what's happening locally enough to tell you, but I'm sure there are examples. What we did and many others have done are creating community-based alternatives to policing, where if you organize and build power, you can get to a place where we can get better accountability through direct action organizing than from calling the cops. So examples of what we would do, we build these circles that could be either in a school-based, workplace-based, neighborhood-based, whatever it was, a building, apartment buildings, or apartment complex, everyone. And you do some training and make agreements about if anything happens to any of us, this is what we're gonna do. And this is how we're gonna take action. And we're gonna do it for each other. It's not that complicated. And from there, I mean, the things that we would do, there was a young woman, I'll give you one example, who was being constantly harassed by this guy, sexually harassed, and she was maybe like 15 at the time. We took a crew of 30 of us to his workplace. He worked in a barbershop in the neighborhood. And we all showed up together with like balloons, whistles, signs, you know, whatever we could to talk about him to his coworkers, to his boss, to his clients, tell him what he was doing to her. She wasn't there. She didn't want to be there. But it was so loud, so annoying, so obnoxious, the dude stopped fucking with her because we were like, we will be back tomorrow and we'll come back the next day. And so, especially in this moment, I feel like there's different ways that we can do it that are direct and what we can talk about. Yeah.
Thanks. So when I heard Alex talk in New York, you made a remark along the lines of what standard operating procedure on Wall Street would be criminal by any moral standard, but very rarely from a legal standpoint. And on the rare occasions that gets punished at all, of course, the punishment is a tiny fraction of what a black person selling by a very weak debt. And of course, you could say the same thing about pharmaceutical industry, the fossil fuel industry, the state department, and so on. So my question is, do you think incarceration is an appropriate approach to dealing with white collar crime, ranging from financial crimes to crimes against humanity? I don't know what approach would you suggest.
Let's get the other question on the table too, because I think we're past time. We don't want to leave while we're still chatting here.
I'll try to keep this fast. I do work with the Queer Coalition of Austin DSA, and like one of the issues I'm banging my head against the wall with is there was a literal SWAT vehicle in the Pride Parade last summer, and I've had some frustrations trying to communicate to other queer people who ought to know better that that's not okay. And so part of eroding police power is getting people to agree that that needs to happen. So I don't, if you have any thoughts or advice about that, I'd appreciate it.
So I'll take the second one first, actually, just because in New York, there is a coalition that is fighting to get the police out of the Pride Parade. So come up and talk to me afterwards, and I will try to remember the name of the person that I've been talking to about this among the 10,000 names in my head these days. But I can hook you up with folks in New York who are fighting this exact same battle, and they've been doing it for a little while, so they have some ideas for you. On the other question about white collar crime. So first of all, we've got this problem about what we mean by justice. So justice has been so degraded as a concept that it's been basically reduced to this idea of revenge. And our criminal justice system is just a giant revenge factory that just chews people up. And because the notion of justice has been so degraded, the people who we know are really causing the harm, when we want justice, we want them punished in the same way. And I think this is a real problem because it just reinforces the legitimacy of revenge and putting people in cages. We need to produce real justice. And that does not have to involve putting people in cages. We have to be a little bit more creative and insightful about how to actually produce justice. It doesn't mean we don't hold people accountable. It doesn't mean that we just give people a slap on the wrist. And it doesn't mean that we need to give longer sentences for white collar criminals and the Manafort's and stuff like this. It means we need to come up with a real vision of justice. So we need to develop some principles about what justice would look like. You know, empowering those who've been harmed, it means repairing the damage. It means taking steps so that these harms aren't repeated over and over and over again, no matter how many people we put in prison. We've got to look at restorative justice practices. We've got to look at truth and reconciliation commissions that have existed around the world, in part because our current idea about justice leaves us in the dark about why these things happen. People go to prison, but we never find out what was really going on. We still don't know like what Manafort was really up to. He can just plead guilty and get some prison time and get out and go right back to doing what he was doing. So we need a lot more thinking about what the real harms are, putting that in perspective, but then a more robust idea about what justice would.
I've got some comments, but I want to hear from the judge on this one.
Well, about rainbow cop cars or the other ones? Because Kim Ogg is America's top gay cop, right? The DA of Harris County. That was the cover of Outsmart magazine like last year, right? So, it's a big problem where I am. And I grew up in the Montrose neighborhood, right, which is where the Lawrence versus Texas case came from. And, the real heart of police oppression. It's so problematic to see a rainbow cop car in Pride Parade. I just can't, maybe I have more useful answers for the other one, but I can't go without saying that. Every day I have cases, right, where and maybe even tied into the question about domestic violence too, right? Like, even in the worst cases, I have to really look at what's available to me and understand that putting this person in a cage is not gonna help, And then I say it, right, up on the thing that looks like this, right? I just don't think that putting this person in cage. In every case, the law requires me to consider the full range of punishment, which includes putting somebody in a cage, right? Which I can do. And which is what you have to do if you want to ever get on a jury and say you can follow the law, right? You can consider the full range of punishment and do whatever you want, right? We can't get there caging people, even in the worst cases, even in the worst DV cases, even in the worst the real wrongdoers in society, right? The owners and the people cracking everybody down. Something that as an anecdote, right? Like, it was a tradition, like Crime Stoppers is not a value neutral organization, right? It's treated that way, right? But it's not. And it funds itself. In fact, I in Midtown, in Houston, there's a brand new Crime Stoppers building named after one of the local TV anchors named Dave Ward, right? But he there's a brand new Crime Stoppers building. And that's funded off these $50 fees in probation cases that historically are not required by law, but it's just this tradition to do $50 Crime Stoppers. And my probation officer came in and said, are we still going to do this? I was like, well, do we have to? He was like, no. And I was like, well, no. But what I say about Crime Stoppers is that, to people that not in this room, right? To just introduce the idea that what Crime Stoppers is really about, I'm just like, well, why don't we put Crime Stoppers ads up in River Oaks, which is where all the owners in Houston live, and make the reward eight or nine figures, in some proportion to the actual harm done, right? And then, and then let's talk about Crime Stoppers, right? But until we do that, it's just really a non-starter, it's obvious what it is. So, but that's kind of me just being cheeky, right? I mean, I really don't, putting people in reproach in prison is not the answer, nor is putting up Crime Stoppers flyers there. So, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I just want to quickly say that, the system currently just can't produce something resembling justice. It just isn't designed for that. What it's designed for is to keep primarily Black and Brown people in a permanent middle class by denying us political rights and job opportunities, by keeping folks with criminal histories unable to participate in our democracy. And an underclass when it comes to actually trying to get jobs. Same thing with the immigration system. It's designed to keep brown people from gaining citizenship so that they can exercise political power in places they live, and to keep them as an underclass so that they only can take jobs that don't provide any benefits or real money to provide for their families and communities. So that's what these systems are designed to do. They might have ancillary things that they also do, that they're also involved in, but that's what their purpose is. And so to expect any form of justice for anything from them, to think that we can rejigger it slightly, since that we get that outcome, I think is the whole issue. We really have a complete transformation that has to happen as it relates to these issues. I think a lot of people are about to again come to that revelation, especially centrists in this country expecting a cop to save them this report drops. So it's not going to happen. The cop's not going to save you. And it's not going to save this country. It's not going to save us from Wall Street, and not going to save us from any of the people who caused this harm. So that's what I'll be doing.
Basically get involved. I know I'm stretching the limit of Alex and other panelists' time already. So just a few quick plugs. First, earlier this morning, around an issue of criminalization of poverty and homelessness in particular, Marina helped host our first canvas to end homeless criminalization in Austin. We're going to be working to help bring down regulations on that. Chris has been a huge help in that. We intend to have some more and file reports, messaging, like a lot of other things, is a lot easier than you would have expected. And there's a lot of opportunities to get involved in decarceration going forward. We do have a criminal justice work group, and we're going to be working primarily on this campaign from now until about May 9th, alongside a related campaign to try and get a public defender's office in Travis County, which all all 15 county judges refuse to sign off on the yes, you can do this. So, as far as I'm concerned, that's 16 people who just signed their own pink slip. Just trying to get at least one of them. Finally,
the other organizations that our panelists are here from are good and like should get involved with them. Austin Just Coalition has a policy meeting tomorrow. I believe, so you can correct me if I'm wrong, we're primarily working on legislative stuff right now. So the things you're talking about, which is training people to go out and do legislative visits, if that's something you're interested in. Schultzgarten tomorrow. Schultzgarten at 3 o'clock tomorrow. CCU is passing around their involvement. I think that, you know, one way or another, a lot of people are going to have to be involved in budget fight. That contract, as Chris noted earlier, took $50 billion out of the police pockets. I'm going to skip the straw poll, but I'm pretty sure that most people in this room do not want any of those dollars to go immediately back into their pockets in the form of higher headcount instead of higher salary. So that's stuff we have to work on. I'd like to thank all of our panelists. This is great. At first I was like, oh no, we didn't get to have more our prepared questions because the answers are good. I think we have to be out of here by 7. So if people want to socialize and you know get to meet some of the panelists or organizers here, that'd be great. Oh, and if you didn't sign in, please do so. We're going to be following up with people, especially DSA members, who want to get involved in criminal justice organizing, so that we can let you know in canvases and stuff.
Yeah, at the DCU, if you haven't signed it, there's a clipboard. We are starting the work around the budget, this year's budget, which gets passed in September, but right now is the beginning with petitions and public hearings going on if you want to get involved. It's not just $50 million that can go back into the policing, but there's all kinds of development incentives that our city gives to build fancy malls, et cetera, that we can impact and stop.